So, good evening. If we can wait a few moments, leaving time for others to join. But, So we can start and others can join later.
Yeah.
So we came to the end of the first chapter of the Gita that text 46. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Sanya Vache Evam Mutva Yuna Sankhira Tupasta Vapishat Vishitcha Sasam Sapam Sukasam Vishnamanasa Sanjay said, Arjun, having thus spoken on the battlefield, cast aside his bow and arrows and sat down on the child, his mind overwhelmed with grief. So now we see that Arjuna had given four reasons not to fight. The first reason was about enjoyment, says I will not be able to enjoy the kingdom. That because with those with whom I want to enjoy the kingdom and for which I want the kingdom, they will not be there anymore. And then he said further, Viparitani, I see just causes of frustration. The opposite is going to happen from what I desire. And then he speaks about papam. We are going to get sinful reactions for killing our relatives. And we heard that he put forward shastra, artha shastra, dharma shastra, which is a higher shastra, and so on. He presented him like a learned person. Then the last argument was, yes, Varnashankara, the family tradition will be destroyed. Women will not be protected anymore. Caste will mix, and so on. And now, finally, he put down his bow. Now, that's significant. Arjuna had put down his bow. To understand how significant this is, Arjuna had vowed that anyone who asked me to put down my Gandiva bow, anyone who even suggests that I put down my Gandiva bow, I vow I will kill him. This is how significant it was. And he's putting it down on the battlefield itself. Once Yudhishthira was fighting with Karna, and Karna defeated Yudhishthira and injured him very severely. So Yudhishthira was terribly insulted by Karna. Karna had said to him, "You are not even a Kshatriya. You should learn how to fight. Look at this, you are defeated. I'm even not going to bother killing you in this way," he said. "You should learn how to fight. Look at this. You are defeated. I'm not going to bother killing you in this way. You are not a Kshatriya, you are a Brahmin. So truthful in anything that is not for a Kshatriya." So to hear that, it wasn't a great compliment. So then he sent him, back to his tent. Yudhishthir was terribly insulted. Karna was laughing how he defeated Yudhishthir and not even killed him, just sent him back. When Arjun heard that Yudhishthir was severely injured, he immediately left the battlefield and he went to the tent and went to see Yudhishthir. When Yudhishthir heard that Arjun had come, then he left the battlefield. Yeah, but when he heard that Arjun had come, so Yudhishthir, he thought that when he heard that Karna had done this to me, so there is no question about it. Arjun is coming, so he must have killed Karna, Yudhishthir was thinking. And now he's coming to tell me about it. I've revenged your honor. That's the nature of a Kshatriya. He did not even think that there would be any way that Arjun would have acted otherwise. That out of affection, he was thinking out of affection, he would already have killed Karna. When Arjun walked in his elder brother's room, Yudhishthir's room, Yudhishthir, whom he loved so much, and he had heard that he had been injured so severely, immediately he came from the battlefield to see how Yudhishthir was doing. He did not fight with Karna at all. He just came and out of deep concern. And Yudhishthir, as soon as he saw him, he said, "Oh Arjun, you have killed Karna and revenged me." And Arjun said, "No, I didn't kill Karna. I just came to see how you are." And Yudhishthir became furious. He said, "You have come here and left the battlefield. You haven't even killed Karna. You fool, how could you have done this? It is better that you give up your Gandiva bow." When Arjuna heard this, he was in great trouble. "Oh no, Yudhishthir suggested that I give up my Gandiva bow and I vowed to kill anyone. Krishna, what do I do?" So Krishna took him aside and said, "You have to kill Yudhishthir now. It's your vow. You should kill him by insulting him." So Yudhishthir was sitting there, feeling a little bad that he had spoken to Arjun like this. And Arjun said, You have the nerve to say that I'm a coward and that I have come here improperly after not killing Karna? But you, look what you have done. You have watched Draupadi being insulted right before your eyes. I would have killed the entire Kaurava army. You are not a man, you are not a king." In this way, he kept on insulting Yudhishthir. In this way, he killed Yudhishthir's pride. As soon as he did it, immediately he went to Yudhishthir and touched his feet and begged for forgiveness. "Please, you have to forgive me," he said. So in this way, the pastime went on, but Arjun had vowed never ever to put down his bow. For he had vowed to kill anyone who even suggested it. Yet his mind was so disturbed by this horrible scene that he is seeing right before his eyes, predicting the most incredible type of disaster and bloodshed for his family members and dearly beloved teacher. That his mind was so disturbed that he cast bow and arrows aside and sat on the chariot, his mind overwhelmed by grief. And remember that this is Arjun. He's not an ordinary fellow. This was a pure heavy Kshatriya, son of Pandu, son of Indra, and how heavy it was for him to take part in this killing. So if we go back in Trent and read Trent text 20, that at that time Arjun, the son of Pandu, seated in the chariot bearing the flag marked with Anuman, took up his bow and prepared to shoot his arrows. There he took up his bow, he's prepared to shoot his arrows. But opposed to this text 20, where it was said, Danur Udyamya Pandava, he picked up his bow, now Vritshidya Chacharam Chapam. He rejects and put it down because he saw the persons on the other side and is affected by all these feelings. Now Yogamaya descended on him and gave him all of these calculated reasonings why he's not going to fight, and he was feeling completely depressed, completely full of lamentation. And so his body was shaking. It is said that his mouth was drying up, his skin was burning. Prabhupada mentions also that he was crying. He was having a nervous breakdown. He couldn't fight. He couldn't even hold the Gandiva bow. He had to put it down, his chapam, his bow. Totally overwhelmed, a totally different Arjuna. This is the Maya Arjuna. Before was the real Arjuna. So, for our benefit, Krishna makes him the instrument for speaking this knowledge that will liberate mankind. Therefore, he places Arjuna in this role. This dialogue between Arjuna and Krishna that is followed is the most important dialogue ever spoken. But Krishna influenced him by Yogamaya so that he will ask the right questions. We will see. So he sits down on the chariot, his head in hand, puts aside a bow, and he starts lamenting like this. You can imagine, at the other side, you have Bhishma, Drona, Duryodhana, Ashwatthama, Kripacharya. They are all watching. They're thinking, what's going on there? Arjuna is not going to fight now. He pulled his chariot in the middle, and the warriors were thinking, what is this? Is he going to fight us alone, or maybe he's going to try to make peace? They couldn't understand why Arjuna brought his chariot in the middle of all the armies. And then there is the conversation going on. And then suddenly Arjuna puts down his bow, and Duryodhana must have thought, oh good, he's giving up his determination, he has lost heart. And Bhishma might have thought, what is Arjuna doing? Won't Krishna speak to him to revive his consciousness? Everyone might have seen it in a different way. It would have been very interesting to hear the thoughts of each person on the battlefield when they saw this. But in case he was crying, he was shaking, he was lamenting, he couldn't possibly see himself fighting in the battle. So there was no way that he was going to fight. And that is what he tells Arjuna in the next chapter. Hey Govinda, I cannot fight this battle. I will not fight this battle. So now we are starting the next chapter 2, that so this chapter 2, yeah, is entitled with the Sanskrit term Sankhya Yoga. So in the second chapter, there we will have Krishna will explain the symptoms of a liberated soul. And it will remove the darkness caused by lamentation and grief by first giving wisdom how to discriminate between matter and spirit. Therefore, this chapter is called Sankhya Yoga. And Arjuna has given 4 reasons until now for not fighting. And there is 1 reason left, which he mentions in the beginning here of chapter 2, that the first reason was compassion for relatives. Now Krishna is going to confront that first objection of Arjuna, but that will be coming from text 11 onwards, in order to dispel Arjuna's lamentation and his darkness. It will give him enlightenment in the form of discrimination between matter and spirit. So that is the way how Krishna revives or relieves Arjuna from his lamentation and his false compassion for everyone. And Krishna then goes ahead for the second reason in the next section like this, one after another. So it is very systematically presented. So in the second chapter begins again with Sanjay speaking to Dhritarashtra that Arjuna has put down his bow, is sat on the chariot, and now Dhritarashtra is feeling great happiness. Oh, Arjuna is not going to fight. Is going to make it a lot easier for my sons to be victorious, to gain victory. So Dhritarashtra was happy. But Sanjay immediately dispelled Dhritarashtra's happiness by this verse, that text 1. Sanjay Uvacha. Tam tata kipaya vistam asu puna kolekshanam. Vishidantam idam vakyam uvacha madhusudana. Sanjay said, seeing Arjuna full of compassion, his mind depressed, his eyes full of tears, Madhusudana, Krishna spoke the following words. So we are taking up from the last chapter. Arjuna put down his bow. He's overwhelmed with lamentation. So here, Sanjay is just restating that. He's covered by that compassion, and his restless eyes are full of tears. He's lamenting. And then he begins to speak to Madhusudan, the king of the, he addressed him before also like that, Madhusudan, the killer of the demon Madhu. So Paladevidya Bhusa, one of the commentators of the Bhagavad Gita, he mentions that the use of the word Madhusudan indicate to Dhritarashtra that the Lord would alleviate or remove Arjuna's lamentation, just as he easily killed the Madhu demon. That's Paul David Yabushan's interpretation. Madhusudan. So Krishna will kill the demon. Or Krishna, which demon? The demon of Arjuna's doubt. The doubts which he expressed in last chapter. So Lord Shiva says in the Brahma Vaivarta Purana that if one remembers Madhusudan amidst great difficulties, then those difficulties turn into his opulences. Yeah, difficulties become opulence. So Arjuna is at last thinking of Madhusudan. We will see that Arjuna's great difficulty will turn into great glory and opulence for the Pandavas. Srila Prabhupada also mentioned this in his purport. The word Madhusudan, he says, is significant in this verse. It is in the discharge of his duty. Here we see Baladev Vidyabhusan's commentary echoed by Srila Prabhupada in his commentary. The more you compare the various commentaries, the more your faith and appreciation of what Prabhupada has done will increase more and more. Because he takes different statements and he presents them in a very simple way for the modern man, but he's coming right in line of all the Gaudiya Acharyas. He's not just making things up. And often he's paraphrasing verses from the Puranas and scriptures, and he's just rephrasing statements from the Acharyas. I see that many times after studying the whole Bhagavatam, that many times Srila Prabhupada is paraphrasing verses and explaining them according to our own time, place, and circumstances, but always in line with the previous acharyas, with the scriptures. Prabhupada presented in a way that he's also expanding the knowledge. He's expanding the knowledge, he's furthering the Gaudiya commentaries. Prabhupada also mentioned that his chapter instructs in self-realization by analytical study of the material body and the spirit soul as explained by the Supreme Authority, Lord Sri Krishna. That's the beginning of the transcendental knowledge which Krishna offers in the Bhagavad Gita. So by calling Krishna Madhusudan, Sanjay is telling Dhritarashtra that these thoughts that are so prominent in Arjuna's mind are now going to be killed by the killer of the demon Madhu. So therefore, Srila Prabhupada explained the word Madhusudan is significant in this verse. Lord Krishna killed the demon Madhu, and now Arjuna wanted Krishna to kill the demon of misunderstanding that had overtaken him in the discharge of his duties. So that's the first verse. The second chapter is also Srila Prabhupada gave it the title Contents of the Gita Summarized, because it gives an overview of all the yoga systems practically. That Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, and it touches also Bhakti Yoga at the end. So text 2. Krishna is speaking. Shri Bhagavan Vacha Kutastva Kasmalamidam Vishame Sam Vastitam Anaya Chistam Ashvaryam Akirti Karam Archana. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said, "My dear Arjun, how has these impurities come upon you? They are not at all befitting a man who knows the value of life. They lead not to higher planets, but to infamy." So that is very interesting. That the common man may think, "Oh, Arjun is a very soft-hearted person. He feels compassion for others. He's a good person. He do not want to commit violence." But the action of Lord Krishna is that he is immediately chastising him very heavily for a kshatriya. So here in the first time is mentioned here, Sri Bhagavan Vacha. So Bhagavan, Krishna is not just some prince from Dvarka, he is Bhagavan. And Prabhupada's commentary is devoted to this point. You see that he will quote Vadanti Tattva, Tattva Vidas. There are three aspects of the Absolute Truth. He mentions, well, he mentions that in his commentary of this verse. There are three aspects of the Absolute Truth. So there is Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagavan, and Bhagavan is the highest. And he mentions six opulences explained by Parasara Muni. Parasara Muni was Vyasadeva in his last life. So Vyasadeva is a Saktya Vesavadar, an empowered incarnation of the Lord. So Rupa Goswami has explained that there are jivas who are empowered, Avesh, Saktya Avesh. They are invested with a certain potency. So Jiva Goswami is also explaining the word Bhagavan in his Bhagavat Sandarbha. He mentioned that the word Bhagavan, Bhaga means opulence. So, Van means one who possesses. So, means opulences. So, it can be denoted from the word Bha, which can be extracted from the word Bhakta, which means maintainer. Lord Krishna says, "I am the goal, the maintainer, the witness, and the most dear friend." The Lord, the 13th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, that he maintains the living entities through light, sunshine, fresh air, water, vegetables, fruits, etc. He also maintains them by giving himself to them, by his pastimes and by sending his devotees to them to spread love of God and coming in the form of various shastras, in the form of deities, the form of holy places. Is coming and maintaining the living entities on a spiritual platform. Also, not just on the material platform. Then Jiva Goswami explains the syllable Ba or Bhaga as the Lord giving transcendental qualities, divine qualities to his devotees. Srimad Bhagavatam mentioned that at the end of the fifth canto, 5.18.12, Yasyasti Bhaktir Bhagavata Kinshana Saverkanastatra Samasatesara Arava Bhaktasya Kutamat Kana Manoratena Satidavato Bhai. So the translation of this verse is that all the demigods and their exalted qualities, such as religious novelist and renunciation, come manifest in the body of one who has developed unalloyed devotion for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. On the other hand, a person devoid of devotional service, engaged in material activities, have no qualities. Even if he is adept to the practice of mystic yoga or the honest endeavor of maintaining his family and relatives, he must be driven by his own mental speculation and must engage in the service of the Lord's external energy. How can there be any good qualities in such a man? So a materialistic man, he has only qualities which are temporary, which are going with the body. But the devotee develops his spiritual qualities. All these spiritual qualities, they are described in the first three verses of the 16th chapter, Divine Qualities, and also at the end in the 12th chapter from verse 14 till 20, so many qualities that are endearing Krishna. So these are that are our eternal qualities, the qualities of the eternal soul. That's different. So there is, of course, Krishna gives also a second aspect, the prema bhakti. He gives prema bhakti to his devotees, not only good qualities, that there's also a third quality. Krishna brings his devotees to his own planet. So other than having opulences, Krishna likes to share his opulences with his devotees. He gives them good quality, he gives them prema, he gives them feelings of separation from his devotees. Yeah. He brings them to his own planet, Goloka Vrindavan. So perhaps a further endearing quality of the Lord. And another definition of the word Bhagavan. Our ceremony had given us the basic meaning. The Jiva Goswami gives us a further meaning. So this is mentioned in Srila Prabhupada, text 16. Srila Prabhupada quotes from the Sandarbhas in his commentary. So in this verse, of course, Krishna says, Kutaha, where is these impurities come from, Arjuna? Because you, Arjuna, you are the son of Indradev, and you are in the royal dynasty of Pandu. All your predecessors were great, fearless warriors, emperors of the earth. You have been trained by Drona. You have given weapons by the Devas. You have been blessed by Indra. And you have so many blessings and the blessings of so many persons, and all of your brothers are depending on you. They were tolerating the exile for 40 years, and we are all depending on you. So come with your Gandiva bow and destroy the army. And now you are on your child, crying like a child, and you are not going to fight. What is this Kutaha? Where did this come from, Arjuna? And especially now, Vishami Samupashtitan. All the kings have come all over the earth planet to fight his battle, for which we were waiting for 40 years. Your brother Bhima is surging with anger. Milk is coming out of his ears, dying to kill the Kauravas. And now you are going to sit down and just forget about everything, giving up the fight, and you go to the forest and sit like a rishi, Arjuna. What is wrong with you? This is Anarya Justam. This is a man. And Anarya Justam is a man of great high qualities. So the word Anarya Justam implies that your action will not be appreciated by the noble and respectful persons, Arjuna. Why are you doing this, Arjuna? Your action will not bring you to Svarga, and neither will it bring you kirti, fame. It's just the cause of infamy. Hey, Arjuna, I think this is not a good decision. So immediately, Krishna gets on his case. He is Bhagavan, and Arjuna is his eternal devotee. So now, Krishna continues in text 3, chastising Arjuna. But before we go to text 3, now in the second text, Krishna begins to speak. He says, where is this sinfulness coming from? You have so many good arguments, but where is this sin, this dirtiness coming from? Anarya, they are not befitting one who is an Arya, one who knows the value of life. Justam Avarhyam, they are not befitting someone who is planning to go to Svarga, the heavenly planets. They are Asvarhyam. Your future is going to be destroyed by your speaking, if you desire like this, that akirti karam arjuna, and this will bring you akirti, infamy, your future asvarhya, no heaven for you, and in the present infamy will be the result of the type of way that you are thinking right now. They do not befit one who knows the value of life. They do not lead to higher plans, but to infamy. This Krishna does not approve Arjuna's compassion. That so in the text 1, Shilpati in the purple, he writes, until compassion, lamentation, and tears are all signs of ignorance of the real self. Compassion for the eternal soul is self-realization. The word Madhusudan is significant in this verse that we discussed already. Text 3. There it starts with another heavy word, Klaibhyam. Vaibhyam ma smagama parta naititvat upapatsyate ksutram idaya darbalyam tvakvotista parantapa. So, klaibhyam means impotence. So, some implied insult is here, like a eunuch. You are a eunuch, Arjuna. You are acting like a eunuch, not as a kshatriya. So this klaibhyam comes in the form of cowardice. For kshatriya, that is lack of potency. Naitatvat upapatsyate. This is never befitting you. Kshudram. It is a very petty thing. Very petty thing. A small thing. And then Krishna used the word Hridaya Darbalyam. And actually it is weakness of heart, because Arjuna is actually arguing with Krishna here. In the commentator's tikkas it is mentioned. No, this is not weakness of heart. Arjuna could say, no, this is not my weakness of heart, they are my religious feelings. This is my discrimination. I decided not to fight based on Dharma. And because of my great compassion for Bhishma, Drona, and all my relatives, why should I fight them? But then Krishna says, oh, Partha, you are the son of Pritha. You are quitting the battlefield. Don't do like this. Don't become impotent or overpowered by attachment to things in this world. But if someone else becomes a Kshatriya Bandhu, you are my close friend and relative. It is, yeah, Kshatriya Bandhu, the friend of a Kshatriya, not a real Kshatriya. You should not become that. You should not become a Kshatriya Bandhu. You are my close friend and relative. It does not befit you to become a Kshatriya Bandhu, a friend of a Kshatriya. So Prabhupada here, he points out in his commentary, Krishna did not want to become an unworthy son of a Kshatriya. Arjuna was the most intimate friend of Krishna. And Krishna was directly guiding him on the chariot. Krishna considered Arjuna's magnanimity, or his compassion for Bhishma, Drona, and his relatives merely weakness of heart. So Arjuna may say that it is due to my religiosity and discrimination that I have decided not to fight. No, this is not correct. This is your weakness of heart, Arjuna. Now keep it up, stand and fight. Fact for this, taparantapa. Para means the others, the enemy, and tapa means to inflict punishment upon them. So he says, you are parantapa, not a eunuch. Now get up and fight. So Prabhupada echoes Srila's Vishvanatha-Sarvadis Thakur commentary in his purport. So if a Kshatriya declines to fight, then he becomes an unworthy son of a Kshatriya. That was a Kshatriya spirit. When challenged, he could never refuse. Never refuse. That he had to fight. But by nature, Kshatriyas like fighting, so they look for an opportunity to fight. But yes, he would become like a Kshatriya Bandhu, an unworthy son of a Kshatriya, like the son of a Brahman who does not study Shastra, that is not peaceful, performs no sense control. Then he becomes a Brahma Bandhu. So here Krishna is saying that don't become a Kshatriya Bandhu, just a relative of a Kshatriya. You have to show you are Parantapa. You have to show that you are a real Kshatriya. Now, in the next verse, Arjuna starts to argue, but before we go to that, the first word Krishna uses in the third verse is klaibhyam, impotence coming from weakness. Kshatriyas must be by nature completely potent. They need not to be proud. They need to have strength of character. And Krishna, to call Arjuna impotent is like a slap across the face, a big slap. O son of Pritha, you are the son of Indradev, the son of the great warrior Pandu. And are you just the son of a Kshatriya Bandhu? In this way, are you impotent, the son of a Kshatriya? Do not yield to this degrading impotence. It does not become you. Give up this petty weakness of heart and arise, Prantapa. It's just of the enemy. He's firing Arjuna up. He does not accept this logic. Sudra means low class petty. He's insulting Arjuna left and right. He's taking advantage of Arjuna's Kshatriya nature, inspiring him to fight. So Arjuna, his answer to this Klaibyam, that is not that this is not impotence or weakness of heart. This is generosity, we'll say, or bigness of heart. So Arjuna is answering. Text 4. That Arjuna Uvacha Katam Bhishma Mam Sankhye Dronam Samadasudam Ishabi Pratyasyami Pujarath Ari Sudana. Arjuna said, O killer of the enemies, O killer of Madhu, how can I counterattack with arrows in battle men like Bhishma and Drona who are worthy of my worship? Respectable, yeah. So he says, yes, Bhishma and Drona. Bhishma is my grandfather, Drona is my teacher. I should worship them. I should do puja for them. So Vidyabhushan said, Arjuna used the same words, or almost the same words, Madhusudan and Arisudan. They are very similar, because they have almost the same meaning. He was in such great anxiety that he not remembered that he already addressed the Lord as Madhusudan. That means that he is so much anxiety at this point. So he's saying, how can I contact in a fight people such as Bhishma? How can I contact them in a fight? Bhishma and Drona, they are worthy of my worship. I should not offer them flowers. I should offer them flowers, not arrows. Pucharav, those who are worshipable should be offered flowers and respect, pranams. Not arrows. They are great persons and they can never be fallen. Or can you ask me to kill my relatives? I mean, you kill persons also, but you don't kill your relatives. You kill demons like Madhu, Yamadusudan. Yadu, the king who was in the Yadu dynasty. You would not kill him, but the demon Madhu. Arisudan, you kill the enemy. You would not kill Sandipani Muni. Would you kill Sandipani Muni, your teacher? Or it says to Krishna, would you kill your relatives? Are you asking me to kill my guru? The Prabhupada mentions Sandipani Muni in his commentary. He mentions Sandipani Muni. He says, Will Krishna ever attack his own grandfather, Ugrasen, or his teacher, Sandipani Muni? These were some of the arguments offered by Arjuna to Krishna. So these are mentioned by Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. So even if Drona or Bhishma are sometimes harsh, they should therefore not be harshly treated. In the Dharma Shastra, the general etiquette is mentioned that superiors are not even to be offered a verbal fight. So Krishna is not Yadusudan, is Arisudan. He kills demons. So Arjuna is mentioning like this, Sandipani Muni or Ugrasena, he would not kill them. Then Arjuna continues in text 5, but before Arjuna is killing is telling Krishna, this is very nice. You are Madhusudan, killer of the killer of Madhu. There are two Madhus. One who is a relative of Krishna's forefather, and the other was a demon. So you are Madhusudan, and you are Arisudan, the killer of the demon. The enemy Madhu that will kill Madhu, the enemy, not your relative Madhu. It is all right for you to kill Krishna. It is all right for you to kill Drona, because you have killed so many. You have killed demons like Madhu, but not your relative Madhu, but Arisudan Madhu. So you have killed the demons, but you are not asking me to kill a demon. You are asking me to kill Bhishma and Drona, who are worthy of being killed, but are pujaro, being worshipful. I should not offer them arrows. They are worship worthy of being worshipped with flowers. Or are you asking to kill them? Now we will text 5. Karuna hatva imanu bhavam Shayo bhaktam vaikshamapiya loke Atvarta kamams to gronya iva punsaya bohan rudira patikhtan. Here Arjun mentions vaiksham, by begging. That I will read the translation. It would be better to live in this world by begging than to live at the cost of the lives of great souls who are my teachers. Even though desiring world again, they are superiors. If they are killed, everything we enjoy will be tainted with blood. So Arjuna wants to become a beggar. Bhiksham, by begging. It would be better for me to become a beggar, because when a kshatriya has no place to rule, then he has no choice. To become a beggar would be a great disgrace. Arjuna thinks, what would be better than killing my relatives? What would be better than winning the kingdom? Because even if I become a beggar, at least I may lose my fame, but at least my future will not be spoiled because of the sin of killing my elders. So it would be better to beg than to kill my teachers. And besides, great souls like Bhishma, they cannot be fallen. And they should never be disrespected. Prabhupada mentioned that Bhishma and Drona were obliged to take the side of Duryodhana because of his final assistance. Although they should not have accepted such position just on financial considerations. Under the circumstances, they have lost the respectability of teachers. But Arjuna thinks that nevertheless they remain his superiors, and therefore to enjoy material profits after killing them mean to enjoy spoils tainted with blood. Someone eats the food of someone who is materialistic, even someone like myself can be affected. So Arjuna is arguing that Bhishma has lost his greatness. That because due to his being connected to the Kauravas, getting financial support and grains and actually eating their food, in this way Bhishma became affected. So of course this is Lila and Yoga Maya, because Bhishma is again a pure devotee, Mahanubhav. They are great souls, so better I become a beggar, he thinks. Actually, this shows Arjuna is a very renounced person because of his great ethics and morality. He would prefer to lose his family and be disgraced as a beggar than actually kill his superiors, which he feels is incorrect. So he's willing to suffer for this idea, his values in life. He was willing to change his whole life. This shows that he is a great character. Now in text 6, he will give arguments, which is, he gives the final argument, which is indecision. So Arjuna then says that it's better for me, even though I'm a Kshatriya, it is better for me to live in this world by begging than to live at the cost of these great souls who are my teachers. So he's remembering his guru. So Krishna, you truly suggest that I kill my guru? You are killing Madhu, but that's quite different from killing one's guru. They are superiors, and they may have done wrong things, yes. Maybe they are polluted by taking grains of Duryodhana, and they did not protest when Draupadi was being insulted. But such great souls, even if they perform acts that are superficially improper, for them there is no question of them falling down. They are still great souls. They are worthy of my worship. And even I do and take over this whole world, even if they desire worldly gains, they are superiors. If they are killed, everything we enjoy will be tainted with their blood. That will not be proper. So this is the first part, the first five verses of the second chapter. We see Arjuna has his doubts because of his attachment to his family members. A very deep attachment. And that attachment prevents him to follow Krishna's order, to become his instrument in the fight. But Krishna will rectify that by speaking this Bhagavad Gita. We can look in our own heart, what is now right now, what is my greatest attachment. Our greatest attachment should become attachment to Krishna. Unless we become attached to Krishna, we cannot regain our spiritual nature, because we are part and parcels of Krishna. So, what's the solution? How can we get rid of this attachment? We have great attachment, but because we are rotating in this birth and death for millions of lives, we have so many attachments. We have to get rid of all of them. And these attachments make us act contrary to our spiritual nature. Act to get something from this material world. That Arjuna wanted to enjoy the kingdom with them, and he was thinking of his sinful reactions. I'm going to suffer. I mine all. That the spiritual focus is just to please Krishna, perform sacrifice for Krishna. That will be explained more deeply in the third chapter. So, are there any considerations, any questions? So, there are no questions, considerations, and we will continue next week, Tuesday, Krishna willing. And if I can travel, then I will be in London on Monday.
Thank you, Maharaj, for giving the inner meanings and detailed explanation for the actions, which is very helpful. Thank you so much.
Yeah, hopefully. That's my purpose of this presentation, is to give a deeper insight in the verses and what's happening with Arjuna and Krishna's teachings. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. Jai Prabhupada.